Good afternoon. The next item of business is portfolio questions, and the portfolio questions this afternoon is social justice, housing and local government. I would ask any member who wishes to seek to ask a supplementary question to please press the request to speak button during the relevant question or enter the letters RTS in the chat function during the relevant question. As ever, I would appreciate succinct questions and answers in order that I can get in as many members as possible. Question number one, Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what actions it is taking to address any issues of damp and mould in social housing.
Cabinet Secretary Shona Robertson.
The latest Scottish House Condition Survey 2019 shows that 99% of social homes are free from damp and 86% are free from any sign of mould. The Scottish Housing Regulator is responsible for monitoring social landlords' progress towards the Scottish Housing Quality Standard, which they are required to meet. The regulator can use its legal powers to intervene where there are problems so that landlords make any improvements they need to make. Scotland's social rented homes have improved over a number of years to meet the standard.
Alexander Stewart.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Many social landlords who own or manage properties across local authorities have admitted they do not place any particular marker on properties to identify if they have damp or mould problems. Therefore, what measures can the Scottish Government put in place to provide financial assistance to support social landlords in order to tackle damp and mould in their properties?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, of course, social landlords are required to use the monies that they receive through rents to ensure that the investment in the properties keeps them to a good standard. As I've said in my initial answer, the condition survey, the latest, shows that on the whole, social homes in Scotland are meeting a good standard, but there's always room for improvement, and that's where the regulator is so important in making sure that the sector is striding to make those improvements where it needs to make them. And of course, we continue as a government to make the investment in social housing more generally so that there are new homes available and of course the investment that can be made in bringing homes up to standard is also important.
A supplementary, Natalie Dunn.
To ask the Scottish Government to provide an update on the pilot on using Internet of Things technology by two Glasgow-based housing associations to measure dampness in their properties, which is being delivered by technology firm North, which has a base within my constituency of Renfrewshire North and West, and has been backed by £3 million enterprise funding by the Scottish Government, and if successful, could be rolled out to other social housing providers.
Cabinet Secretary.
So I can tell Natalie Dawn that we very much welcome this trial and support technological innovations that will help social landlords improve the condition of their homes. The pilot will see sensors in homes share real-time data through the Internet of Things Scotland network to help local authority and housing associations to proactively intervene and minimise issues including damp and mould. And the development was supported by £2.7 million of funding by the Scottish Government, £150,000 by Scottish Enterprise and £30,000 from Highlands and Islands Enterprise, and we'll be taking a close interest in the outcomes of this ongoing trial.
A supplementary, Ariane Burgess.
The tragic death of Awad Ishaq raises the very serious impact on people living in damp and mouldy housing. This is a problem across Scotland, exacerbated by our climate and often poorly insulated and ventilated housing. I have a constituent with three children living in a Highland Council property that has considerable mould and damp. My constituent provided the council with a GP letter detailing that the children's breathing problems are due to mould, but the council has been slow to take action. Given the cost to health services, as well as people affected of damp homes in ways, in what ways is the Scottish Government working to ensure that prevention of ill health through improved housing conditions is a reality in practice?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, firstly, can I say to Ariane Burgess that the death of Awab Ishaq is absolutely a tragedy and nobody should lose their life due to poor housing conditions. I'm also very concerned to hear about her constituents and would be happy to look further into the detail of that if the member would like to provide me with those details. At present, there are defined minimum standards, and while we don't specify what measures landlords should fit, insulation would normally be needed in order to meet the required level of energy efficiency. And although housing conditions in Scotland have been gradually improving, we do recognise that there's more work to do, which is why we've committed to developing a new housing standard. But as I say, if Ariane Bauer just wants to write to me with the detail, I'll look into the details of the case.
Question number two, Jackie Bailey.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on what work it has undertaken to help Homeless Project Scotland find premises in Glasgow.
Cabinet Secretary.
So the Scottish Government officials maintain regular contact with Homeless Project Scotland and Glasgow City Council, and have encouraged the charity to continue to engage with the Council and to explore accommodation options. The Council is best placed to support the charity with identifying suitable premises, and I understand they have offered properties to Homeless Project Scotland. These were declined, so the Council continues to explore potential sites. However, I'm aware to date that there's a limited number of available properties that meet the charity's specific requirements, but I would encourage both to keep discussing.
Jackie Bailey.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response? She will, of course, remember that it was in April this year that the First Minister said, and I quote, "I am happy to engage with the Homeless Project to see whether there is more that we as a government can do to help it find a building." 7 months on, winter is well and truly here, and with numbers of homeless people increasing and the use of the soup kitchen increasing due to the cost of living crisis, nothing has really changed. I welcome the engagement, of course I do, but can the Cabinet Secretary tell me why there has been little progress to date and what she can do to help secure premises for this very worthwhile project?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, first of all, can I say to Jackie Bailey, you know, we are concerned as well about people queuing up in the street for food, particularly in the winter, and we would all want the outcome of appropriate premises to be found. Jackie Bailey will also understand that it's not for the Scottish Government to be able to procure and find a building. That is for Glasgow City Council. What we can do, though, is to encourage both parties to continue to discuss. Jackie Bailey will be aware of some of the issues around the properties that were offered. But we need to see some solutions here. Glasgow City Council are best placed to find those properties that could meet Homeless Project Scotland's needs, but there will need to be discussion, dialogue and perhaps compromise from both parties.
Supplementary, Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Shelter Scotland, in their Scottish Housing Emergency Action Plan, call on the Scottish Government to conduct an audit of all homelessness funding, national and local, to identify the true levels of investment and also to identify shortfalls, which is often leading to the situation Jackie Bailey's outlined. Will the Scottish Government undertake to do that?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, we will always keep funding under review. We're in the middle of a budget process that Miles Briggs will be aware of. And of course, if Miles Briggs wants to bring forward some proposals around funding, then of course we will consider those. But in addition to the resourcing that local government gets through its funding, we provide additional funding through the £100 million for the Ending Homelessness Together. Some of that is, of course, focused on things like Housing First, and there's been a lot of success there in making sure that Housing First supports people with not just a tenancy, but the wraparound support that is required. So we will keep these things under review, but I don't think anyone can really question the commitment we've made on some of the world-leading homelessness legislation, and we've backed that up with real investment as well.
Question number three, Ros McCall.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the latest homeless death 2021 figures from the National Records of Scotland, which show that an estimated 250 homeless people died in 2021.
Cabinet Secretary.
These figures serve to remind us of the human story behind the statistics and drives our commitment to do all we can to prevent homelessness from happening in the first place. We know that experience of multiple forms of extreme disadvantage is linked to higher rates of ill health and premature death. The National Mission on Reducing Drug-Related Deaths includes work to strengthen partnerships between health and homelessness services to improve outcomes for people experiencing homelessness with complex needs. An independent evaluation shows Scotland's Housing First programme can transform the lives of people with difficult experiences of homelessness.
Ros McCall.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. She will be aware that the latest available statistics from the National Records of Scotland show that homelessness death rate in Fife has trebled since 2017. Statistics from Ireland following their own rent freeze show that a 30% increase in the rate of homelessness after that rent freeze went into process. So what evidence does the Cabinet Secretary have that this SNP Green Government's recent Rent Freeze Act will not make an appalling set of statistics in Fife even worse?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, first of all, the rent freeze, of course, was to help tenants afford their rents, and it's very disappointing that the Conservatives didn't recognise the fact that in a cost of living crisis, partly caused by her own UK government, that tenants are going to struggle to pay their rents. Therefore, the rent freeze is to help tenants afford their rents, and that was the whole reason for it. In a cost of living crisis, I would have thought the Conservatives might have supported such a measure. In terms of going forward with that, the member will be aware that the rent freeze is in place until the end of March, and we've set a number of criteria to look at whether that will be extended. And of course, we're in dialogue with the social rented sector around an agreed outcome with them, which will be announced soon. In terms of drug deaths, I've set out the complex nature of homelessness deaths, rather, and the relationship with multiple forms of extreme disadvantage relating to things like drug-related deaths. So we need to understand the complexity of this, and I think to try and link it to a rent freeze is a rather simplistic look at what is a very complex issue. And we'll continue to tackle homelessness. We'll also continue to invest in reducing drug-related deaths through the investment of the £250 million over the course of this Parliament. We will continue to do that because we are concerned about the human stories and tragedies behind these statistics.
Brief supplementary, please, Co-Cab Stewart.
Thank you. These figures are, as the Cabinet Secretary rightly said, heartbreaking, and my thoughts are very much with everyone who has lost a loved one. In addition to the measures already outlined, could the Cabinet Secretary provide further detail on the legislative measures the Scottish Government is taking to tackle homelessness, in particular on the suspension of the local connection test, which came into force this week, and also measures in the forthcoming housing bill?
Briefly, please, Cabinet Secretary.
So, local connection requirements have long been recognised as a barrier to people realising their rights, which is why we've removed them. Most people who are homeless want to live in a community where they're already settled, but this legislation gives people choice about where they live. And the forthcoming housing bill includes rental sector reforms, further strengthening existing rights for tenants, and introduces new homelessness prevention duties.
Question number four, not lodged. Question number five, Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its position is and whether current funding provisions will enable local authorities to meet the standards in its housing strategy regarding social housing, including energy efficiency.
Minister Ben McPherson.
Whilst it is for local authorities to determine how they use funds provided to maintain housing stock and ensure compliance with relevant standards, at least £1.8 billion over this parliamentary term will be allocated to help retrofit heat and energy efficiency measures. This includes our £200 million Social Housing Net Zero Heat Fund, which is designed to accelerate the delivery of energy efficiency measures and zero emissions heating systems in social housing. Social landlords can also access the £300 million Heat Networks Fund. We recognise the challenges that social landlords face and continue to have constructive engagement with them on these and a range of matters.
Brian Whittle.
Yeah, I can thank the Minister for that answer, but I've been contacting local authorities to ask them the very same question. As some have stated, they cannot meet the energy efficiency standard for social housing too within their HRA revenue alone, while others suggest the levels of current support are not enough to meet the Scottish Government heat and building strategy and new supply programme within existing timescales while keeping rents frozen. So can I ask the Minister, when the Scottish Government initialised the rent freeze, did they consider the unintended consequence of the social housing strategy, especially targets on energy efficiency, and irrespective of this, whether or not what they're going to do about it to ensure these important targets are met?
Minister.
The Scottish Government has continued to have very constructive conversations with social housing providers in the same spirit as has been outlined by the member, to gather evidence on the impact of a freeze on the freeze on rents and on reaching agreement in relation to rent setting in the social sector, and that constructive engagement continues. In terms of energy efficiency, social landlords have already made substantial investment in energy efficiency to remove poor energy efficiency as a driver for fuel poverty and to contributing to achieving the Scottish Government's ambitious climate change emissions reduction targets. I note the points that the member has raised and will certainly look to feed back to him through colleagues on those points, if that would be of constructive assistance.
And supplementary, Willie Rennie.
The Cabinet Secretary indicated last time that mid-market rentals run by social landlords could be classed as social housing with regards to rent capping provisions. But in a written answer to me, Patrick Harvey told me the opposite. He said mid-market homes are let under private tenancy arrangements. So can the Minister help me? Are mid-market rents social or private?
Minister.
The Ministerial colleagues will write with further clarity to Mr Wren. I appreciate this isn't on energy efficiency, but we will follow up on that question.
Thank you, Minister. Question number 6, Russell Finlay.
To ask the Scottish Government how it supports local authorities to ensure that the provision of local services meets the need of local communities.
Minister Ben McPherson.
The Scottish Government works constructively in partnership with local government, engaging regularly and collaborating extensively to serve and support communities. However, we also respect and appreciate that it is the responsibility of individual councils to manage their own budgets and for local democratically elected councillors to make decisions on how best to deliver services in their local communities on the basis of local needs and priorities.
Russell Finlay.
Thank the Minister for that answer. Pupils and parents celebrated the opening of Dargavel Primary School 6 months ago, but parents and others in the community warned that Renfrewshire Council that the school was half the size it needed to be, and they were right. The school can take 548 pupils. It needs space for 1,100. The Council has apologised but says it can't explain its monumental incompetence to deliver this vital local service. So can the Minister for Local Government use his position in any way to find out why this local authority got it so badly wrong and how it would put right?
Minister.
I appreciate the nature in which the member has raised this issue on behalf of his constituents, and it is clearly an important issue for his region and for those he represents. However, I would direct him to the local council on this matter in order to emphasise the points to the council and the concerns that he has and his constituents have. I'm sure he would appreciate that it would be inappropriate for ministers to intervene in matters that are the responsibility of local councils and the responsibility in terms of holding the council to account of locally elected councillors. However, we will note his concerns, and I'll certainly relay this question to the Education Secretary for her information. But again, I would encourage the member to take the matter up with the local authority.
And supplementary, Gillian Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Without the full fiscal powers of a normal European state, the Scottish Government has consistently delivered as fair and affordable settlement as they can within the fixed budget that they get. Will the Minister underline to his counterparts in the UK Government that Scottish local authorities need investment from all levels of government to meet the needs of communities as they grapple with this cost of living crisis?
Minister.
It is important to recognise that Scotland's settlements from Westminster have suffered a decade of austerity from 2010 to 2011, with average real terms cuts of over 5%. This equates to a loss of £18 billion over that period. Despite this, local authority revenue funding is £2.2 billion, or 22.9% higher in cash terms in 22-23 than it was in 23-24. 2013-14. The UK Autumn Statement does not go far enough to ensure that the Scottish Government can fully support our people, communities and businesses through the most challenging financial situation since devolution. And of course, finance ministers are working through the implications of the UK Government's budget and will announce our plans in the forthcoming Scottish budget later this month.
Question number 7, Annie Wells.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what progress has been made in the last 6 months in removing dangerous cladding from buildings.
Cabinet Secretary Shona Robson.
The safety of residents and homeowners is our absolute priority. We are taking forward a robust programme of comprehensive and technical assessments through our Single Building Assessment Programme, which in the last 6 months has been expanded to more than 100 buildings. Assessments are being completed and discussions on remediation underway. And whilst we expect the vast majority of buildings to be found to be safe, if issues need immediate action to safeguard residents, then we will take action. We're also working through Homes for Scotland with housing developers on our Safer Building Accord.
Annie Wells.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. I was recently contacted by a group of residents in Glasgow who were astonished to discover they had been presented with remedial bills running into tens of thousands of pounds due to flammable material found in the cladding in their buildings. If these charges are not met, many of these residents will face extremely difficult choices and could possibly lose their homes. After turning to their local MSP in Glasgow, they were told the Scottish Government has no money to help them. Can I ask what action the Scottish Government is taking now to support residents like my constituents and whether the Cabinet Secretary will join me to meet with them to discuss financial support in more detail?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, of course, I will meet with them, and if Annie Wells in advance of that could send me some detail, I would want officials to look into that, because communication with homeowners around these matters is very important. And you know, when I said in my initial answer that we take immediate action to safeguard residents, we have taken action, and that includes some waking watches, which Scottish Government itself is helping to fund. So the issues here are also about responsibility, though. And what we've said is that the £400 million that we've committed to this programme of work, and we've spent almost £1 million so far on assessments, that the remediation needs to be the responsibility of a developer where a developer can be found in connection with the property. Where there's no developer to be found or they don't exist anymore, that's where the Scottish Government will step in order to fund any remediation work. So I'm not sure what the details are around this case, but I'm happy to look into it if Annie Wells will furnish me with the details.
And question number 8, Liam MacArthur.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to Age Scotland's report, Keeping the Doors Open.
Minister Christina McKelvey.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. We recognise that community groups are a source of support, particularly in these difficult times, and also that there are challenges for some, so we will closely consider the report's recommendations. We have committed to investing to tackle social isolation and loneliness and invested £1 million last year for immediate work, including helplines, befriending and practical support, and we continue to work with the Social Isolation and Loneliness Advisory Group, of which Age Scotland is a very valued member. Also, the Community's Mental Health and Wellbeing Fund also tackles social isolation and loneliness and mental health inequalities, and £36 million have been made available for that this year too.
Liam MacArthur.
Can I thank Christina McKelvey for that response? As she'll be aware, Age Scotland's report reveals the extent of the COVID-related pressures facing our older people's groups across Scotland. Plugging gaps in statutory services has dramatically increased demand for assistance from these groups. In Orkney, dementia diagnoses aren't being made, and NHS Orkney is withdrawn from podiatry, placing huge pressure on Age Scotland Orkney services. So will the government accept Age Scotland's call for a national fund to support older people's community groups to help members through the cost of living crisis? And will ministers rethink the decision to remove funding from the Men's Shed movement, which risks undermining an initiative that does such vital work in Orkney and communities across Scotland?
Minister.
Yep. Thanks very much for that question. And I know that local authorities local organisations and lots of charities and third sector organisations are really feeling the pinch with the cost of living crisis, and that's having an impact on the work that delivered. On men's sheds in particular, Presiding Officer, I've visited many men's sheds and they've always been a joy to visit because they not only just do the work that men's sheds do, they do lots of community work and lots of public health work too. And we've gone from 5 men's sheds in 2013 to over 200 today. So the Scottish Government has provided £570,000 since then, 2014-15, and Age Scotland, we've provided £150,000 to them for men's sheds too. In this year, Presiding Officer, £75,000 has been made available to help Scottish Men's Shed Association build further success as they continue to develop their business model with new funding partners to come on board. And on the point of particular issues in local areas, especially areas in rural or island communities, I'd be happy to speak further with Liam MacArthur on what more we can do in those areas.
A supplementary, Bill Kidd.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To the Age Scotland report calls on the Scottish Government to continue to recognise loneliness as a key public health issue. Can I ask, therefore, what work the Scottish Government is doing through its national strategy to tackle loneliness and social isolation?
Thank you. Minister.
Thanks very much for that question. In the first 100 days of this Parliament, we invested £1 million for immediate work by organisations tackling social isolation loneliness, including those helplines, befriending networks and practical support, but we also committed to investing in and supporting organisations to tackle this public health issue. We are working with Social Isolation and Loneliness Advisory Group, of which Age Scotland, as I said, is a very valued member of that group, to create a new delivery plan to mitigate the impact of COVID-19 and the ongoing cost of living crisis on groups most adversely affected. We expect to publish the new delivery plan in early 2023, outlining a range of actions the Scottish Government will take to deal with social isolation and loneliness, and I hope the member will look out for that and share it as widely as possible.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes portfolio questions on social justice, housing and local government. There will be a very short pause before we move on to the next item of business to allow those who wish to change position to do so. Thank you.